Stars aflame in Atlanta. Grissom and DJ come out unscathed. The NHRA Stars blast into Florida, a win Al Hoffman won't soon forget. And in Daytona, hey, that pavement's plenty tough, but this Rough Rider will be back to battle again. Grab the goodies. We've got the damage report for you on race day, Sunday night, March 9th, 1997. Well, good evening. Welcome to race day. I'm Rick Benjamin. A wild day coast to coast. Unfortunately, everyone appears to be okay, and one Ford driver may be on his way to a title. Well, coming into Atlanta today, you know, Dale Jarrett had led more Winston Cup laps than anybody this year, but he hadn't been to victory lane yet. Would round four of the 1997 season finally be his day? It started off, at least, to be a landmark day for rookie pole sitter Robbie Gordon. Robbie, in just his 12th career Cup start, led early today at Atlanta. Guy on the charge early, how about the defending race winner, the Goodwrench 3, Earnhardt. He started 26th, up to 7th in the first 40 laps. And Ernie Irvin in the 8th Ford started 17th, makes it to 4th in the early going. Debris on the track brought out the first caution of the day on lap 44. The leader's pit, and Jeff Bodine, on a sweet roll early this year, loses his left rear wheel in a couple of laps of the bargain. Green again on lap 52. Robbie backing up, and Dale Jarrett looking for his first Atlanta Cup win takes over. Biggest cheer of the afternoon, how about this? Jeff Gordon, strong in the early going, loses an engine. He's the first car out this day. Well, the 8's cars were super tough, and it was a tough day for Greg Sachs. Fast in the rear Walsh Ford. Contact here with Sterling Marlin. Sachs belts the wall on the backstretch. The only anxious moment of the day really here for the leader. 190 laps down, the ignition in the 88 car dies. Flames from the headers. Irvin gets by. But Jarrett switches to his backup ignition box and continues in second. Kenny Schrader and Ricky Rudd would have their days end early. Joe Nemechek and Gary Bradbury would tangle two down the main straight. And then with 60 laps left off turn two, Ted Musgrave crosses up. Rusty can't stay off the fence. Ricky Craven, trying to sneak by, drills the 16 car hard. Green again, fuel an issue for some cars, but right away a huge wreck. Backstretch now. Jimmy Spencer's loose. Steve Grissom tries to avoid him. Mike Skinner wants to thread the needle. Grissom's 41 car goes backwards, full speed into the inside backstretch wall. Shears the rear of the car off completely. The gas tank catches fire. The car is destroyed. Steve, fortunately, is okay. They red flagged this one for an hour. Finally, the restart with 38 to go. No one had anything for the 8's cars. Morgan Shepherd, who's always tough here, moves Richard Jackson's Pontiac into third. But at the flag, it's all Dale Jarrett. He led half the season's laps coming in. He gets his first win of 1997. Teammate Irvin finishes second. Shepherd gets third. Earnhardt comes home eighth. Terry Labonte and Bobby Hamilton, the rest of the top 10. Here's how the points stack up after four races. DJ now the leader. Labonte, Martin, Gordon falls to fourth. The Cup Stars get next weekend off, returning to action in 2 weeks, March 23rd at Darlington Raceway. All the highlights for you here on race day. Well, the fastest race cars on pavement were roaring this afternoon in Florida. The NHRA Stars making their third stop of 1997. The Gator Nationals. You saw the finals here this afternoon live on TNN. Wild action in all four pro categories. Pro Stock Bike. First race of the new year, David Schultz gets away fast, and he beats Matt Hines a 7-3-21 ET. Schultze gets the victory. Pro Stock now, the professor Warren Johnson already with a new national speed record in hand at 199.91. Didn't get to the finals. Jim Yates far side as McDonald's Pontiac. Fresh off that split with engine ace Richard Maskin. Faces off with Mike Edwards. Yates gets the drop and the win. 6-9-59 for the victory. Yates' second victory of the year. Top fuel, Mike Dunn, Joe Amato. Amato near side. They're even halfway down, but Dunn gets the wheels up, has to back out. Amato picks up another national victory. And in funny car, Al Hoffman close to you, unsponsored. Mark Oswald in the In-N-Out Burger car, far side. They light him up. Oswald lights up his tires. Hoffman, though, in trouble halfway down. Watch this. The engine blows. The chutes burn. Hoffman gets into the wall. He'll flip his Pontiac. He's okay. Talk to his crew. Wild way to win his first of the year. John Force, by the way, was out in the round of 16. The NHRA Warriors get a week off. They race next. The Slick 50 Nationals in Houston. The finals of that one come up on March the 23rd. We'll have all the highlights right here. A little later on race day, we'll go back to Atlanta for more on the Prime Star 500 and a blue oval surprise. But first, a record-setting Russell at Big D, the fast finale of Bike Week when race day rolls on. That's when the Super Bowl of motorcycle racing, the Daytona 200, is the biggest bike road race in the world. It's a mystery there for the making on this race day. Pole sitter Scott Russell, he'd set a qualifying record, but Colin Edwards, his World Superbike teammate, would lead briefly on the 45 here. Russell, though, able to get past Edwards. Hold on to the point for a while, although some ignition problems would come up here and catch Colin Edwards. Watch this. Edwards would have to wiggle and hold on. He would take the bike off the road. He's okay. Finally gets it straightened up, but he would lose several spots. Now, defending Superbike champ Doug Chandler in that number one plate gets by Russell to lead here in the backstretch chicane. Takes the pack up into the banking of turn three. Remember last year's 200, that rematch between Russell and Miguel Duhamel never really got going. Miguel had tire troubles, goes a lap down, had to make a couple of pit stops here. Now, Scott Russell really dominated the day at Daytona, but he had his hands full a lot of the way this afternoon with the heavy on-track traffic. As he worked the pack, he would signal the other riders, working his way around. Russell built up a 20-second lead and a couple of points today. The lead goes away here. Dean Mizdahl on the 36 loses an engine as he climbs out of the turn one banking, tries to hold on, gets high-sided. The bike catches fire briefly. Mizdahl is injured. He is okay, we are told. Russell had a few more exciting moments trying here to keep Duhamel a lap down with two remaining. Almost loses it in the S's, nearly throws it away. But Scott Russell on bike number four, stout all day, hangs on into the tri-oval. Looks like a replay of last year's finish. But remember, Duhamel on the yellow bike is a lap down. Scott Russell wins his record fourth Daytona 200. Chandler will be plenty busy anyway here on TNN. We've got a live racing doubleheader for you. We'll have more on that in a couple of moments. Dale Jarrett has now picked up his first win of the Winston Cup season, the second straight by a Ford. One winner today, but many more who came very close. Race Day's Matt Yocum has more for us from Atlanta.
Rick, this little oil trail changed the face of the points race here in Atlanta. Jeff Gordon's blown engine not only ended his top five streak at six, but it dropped him from first in the point standings.
Well, yeah, we're going to lose more than a few. We're going to lose a lot. And, you know, that, I mean, yeah, it was nice to have those wins and have that points lead because we won't lose as much. But at the same time, you know, we're losing a lot of points that we're going to have to fight hard to make back up.
Consistency is the difference in any title race. If one man has it, it's Dale Jarrett. Today's win is his third straight top three finish, and it propels the 88 team into the points lead.
That's what it's about, is being here week in and week out. That's how you win championships. And we think that we learned enough about a championship last year that we can really go for it this year and be there. You got to be there every week. And I think that we've proven with each different type of racetrack we've been through so far that we're ready for the challenge.
Before today's 500-miler, NASCAR handed down a rule change, allowing the four teams to lower their front balance an eighth of an inch. It proved fruitful as Fords took five of the top 10 spots.
You know, we sure would have liked to have won the race, but, you know, there's always somebody that's a little bit better, and DJ was a little bit better, so you know, that's just part of it. We'll take second, and we'll go home and get ready for Darlington.
And for the third straight trip to Atlanta, three teams won't be leaving with their cars tonight. They're heading up the road to Lockheed, so NASCAR can get their first opportunity to get some wind tunnel time and check out the aero numbers of the three makes that run on the NASCAR Winston Cup circuit. Rick?
All right, thanks a lot, Matt. I guess that could mean more changes in the offing. Here's the line on Atlanta today. Ford dominated the top of the leaderboard. Five of the top seven spots to Ford. But a good week for Pontiac's teams, too. Six of their seven cars finishing in the top 13, led by Morgan Shepherd in third. Do you know what that means? Well, only two Chevrolets made the top 13 today. We'll keep you posted on those aero numbers and any rules changes after the wind tunnel tests that start tomorrow. As we mentioned a moment ago, the Winston Cup stars take next week off, but many of them will be busy anyway. We've got a very busy Sunday for you next week, a live motorsports doubleheader. First from Homestead Motorsports Complex in Florida, the NASCAR Craftsman Trucks, the Florida Dodge Dealers 400, starts at 1 o'clock Eastern after race day. And then right after that, live from Las Vegas at 4 p.m. Eastern, the Las Vegas 300. The Busch Grand National stars of NASCAR make their first debut, their first run at Las Vegas. Big money, almost $900,000 on the line. Nine Winston Cup drivers are entered at Vegas to battle the BGN Warriors. Maybe Mark Martin will make the tow west to try for four straight wins. We'll see. We'll have preview coverage here on race day at noon Eastern next Sunday on TNN. We hope you can join us. Well, the last of racing's major series to open up the new season, the Formula One Circus, starting off 1997 Down Under, the Australian Grand Prix late last night, U.S. time, in Melbourne. Attrition was the big story in this one. Even before the race, defending world champion Damon Hill, hoping to make his first start of the Aero Yamaha, and his run end on the warm-up lap with a throttle problem. On the green light, lap one, and Eddie Irvine and Johnny Herbert and pole sitter Jacques Villeneuve all got together in a crash. And then John Alesi would be embarrassed, too. There's the aftermath of that early wreck. Alesi ran out of gas. He was trying to go the distance with just one pit stop. Most of the Formula One opener was dominated by Heinz-Harald Frentzen, looking for his first career victory in F1. But he lost the lead after a long pit stop. And then this, a brake disc let go, throwing him into a wild spin. That left the race to David Coulthard of Scotland. His victory for Coulthard, only his second career in Formula One. Coulthard's victory ending a 46-race drought for Team McLaren back to 1993. Michael Schumacher challenged late in the Ferrari, but an unscheduled pit stop dropped him to a distant second. Mika Hakkinen, Gerhard Berger, and Olivier Panis, the top five. Formula One teams stay below the equator for their next stop, the Grand Prix of Brazil, in 2 weeks, and we'll have highlights for you right here. Well, some changes in U.S. road racing to update for you this week as well. IMSA confirming they're going to move their corporate headquarters to Las Vegas, to the new Las Vegas Motor Speedway at the end of this season, as soon as the new headquarters building is completed. The move actually will come under the umbrella of IMSG, the Speedway Group that is IMSA's parent company. IMSA has a nighttime race booked for Las Vegas this fall. And we're told that IMSA will announce a name and logo change late this week, right before the 12 hours of Sebring. The new name, we're told, may include the term World Sports Car. We'll let you know here next Sunday. Another racetrack the IMSA Tour will visit this summer, seeing a major shift this past week. International Speedway Corporation, Daytona's parent company, buying the remaining 50% of Watkins Glen International that ISC didn't already own from Corning Incorporated. Corning and the Speedway Corporation had bought the 3.4-mile road course out of bankruptcy in 1983. ISC President Bill France Jr. says the purchase immediately adds value for our shareholders. IMSA races at the Glen again in June. Earlier, we took you to Daytona for the grand finale.